Hello, and good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on when and where you are watching this video series on Singularity. My name is Scott Coughlin, and I'm a member of the NUIT Research Computing Services team. In this video series, we will have four parts. First, we are going to discuss in today's video why containers, so that you can understand if containers are right for you and your particular workflow and your particular software. In the second video, we're going to go over some of the basics regarding using a container. So this is going to include basic commands to execute your container and software inside your container, as well as how you can mount or bind directories on your host system into the container that might not be mounted by default. In the third video, we are going to explore how you can build your own container as opposed to using a pre-made container that's available on something like Docker Hub, which we'll talk about later in today's video. Finally, in the fourth and final video of this series, we're going to cover some advanced topics. These topics are going to include how you can make a module to conveniently wrap your container to make calling the executables or the functions inside your container simpler, as well as how to run a container if the program you installed inside the container is an MPI-enabled program. As with all of our video series, the structure for each video is going to be a set of slides to provide some context for the theme of the day. And then we're going to end with an exercise, which we will perform live on Quest, which is Northwestern's computing cluster. So, to ask the question if a container makes sense for you, you want to ask yourself if you've ever wondered these questions while trying to install your program or someone else's program on a shared computing system like Quest. So, have you ever had to create a virtual machine that had a completely different operating system on it? Think maybe Ubuntu or CentOS or Windows or Mac. That was different than your host operating system because you knew that the installation instructions were written and only guaranteed to work for that operating system. Have you ever had issues trying to move your installation scripts from machine to machine, computer to computer, host to host, and found that you have to make these annoying small tweaks every time you move from, say, your laptop to a supercomputer or from your a supercomputer to a different supercomputer, and found that you had to make these slight tweaks every single time? Or have you ever had problems where a workflow that was working for months due to some change that an admin made either to the operating system of the machine that you're running on? Let's say, you're running on Mac and it moved from Mojave to Catalina or to Big Sur, or if someone messed with a module that was on a computing cluster that was working forever, but then someone accidentally tweaked it and it broke your workflow. Finally, and probably most importantly for a lot of people, shared computing systems like Quest don't allow super user commands to be run. So you can't yum install or apt-get install or sudo install anything. And perhaps that's been annoying because the instructions for your particular program assume that you have this ability. Okay. So if you've ever had these kind of issues happen to you in the past, containers, may be for you. Okay. So how do containers solve this? Containers solve these issues by allowing you to bootstrap from pretty much any operating system you can think of. And what we mean by bootstrap is essentially a baseline product is available for things like Ubuntu or CentOS that you can then build on top of. So imagine it's almost like somebody is shipping you a virtual machine and you can then enter that virtual machine and install whatever you want into it. It's kind of similar. It's not, containers are not virtual machines, but they act like a more portable, flexible virtual machine in some respects. The other thing it allows you to do is to literally copy wholesale these image files from system to system. So you don't have to go from a workflow on Quest that you already installed and know works correctly to say Exceed and have to redo the instructions and hope they work on Exceed. You can literally take the image file and just copy it to Exceed and you'll know that it works. The other thing it does is that containers are isolated and are not allowed to be modified except during the build stage of the container. So if you share it with collaborators, they will not accidentally upgrade Python or upgrade NumPy to a version that doesn't work with the rest of your packages in your virtual environment, let's say, or the admins can't change a module that will then change a library that makes it so that your workflow doesn't work. The container is wholly isolated and whatever is in it after the build stage cannot be modified once you clone it down, copy it down to your local host system. And finally, at the build stage, it is required that you have super user privileges to build a container, and therefore you have the ability to run apt-get or yum install like commands. And so you will have the ability to install things with super user privileges when you build a container. Okay. So I like to think of containers as taking Anaconda virtual environments to the next level. So let's say maybe you're familiar with virtual environments, but those virtual environments still rely on the underlying host operating system. So if it's your laptop, maybe it's Mac or Windows, or if you're on a computing cluster, maybe it's Red Hat Linux 7. And it still requires that what you install from Anaconda plays well with the underlying operating system and libraries, et cetera, that are available in that operating system. And more importantly, it also requires that the dependency or the thing that you want and need to install exists on Anaconda. Whereas with containers, you can use apt-get or yum, which are like the operating system's internal package managers to install packages. And generally speaking, although not always, you might find that there are more packages and more versions of packages available via these managers than there are via the Anaconda package manager. Okay. All right. So how do we actually run containers? So there are two premier programs to run container. The first is Docker. Docker is great for non-HPC systems. So why is Docker great for non-HPC systems? Well, it requires to not only to build the container, but to run it, you have to have super user privileges. And on a shared high performance computing system like Quest, you will never have super user privileges. So in comes Singularity. Singularity is very similar to Docker, but it allows you to run containers as just a regular user. However, if you want to build a container using Singularity, much like you can build a container using Docker, that will require super user privileges. And so we'll explain how to get around that issue when we get to the build video in this series. Where do containers live? Like, just like Anaconda packages live on Anaconda Cloud or Conda Forge, Docker containers have cloud repositories as well. There's Docker Hub, which I referred to earlier in this video, bio containers, NVIDIA manages, and ships a lot of containers for use on GPUs. And there are other locations that you can find pre-built containers that may already have installed the software that you're looking to run on Quest for you. Okay. So what does it look like to go to Docker Hub? So when you go to Docker Hub and you search for a container, in this case, I looked for Ubuntu, because as I mentioned, there are containers that come with the Ubuntu operating system prepackaged in them. You can see here, this is what the page will look like. And it will explain to you how you could clone or download this container using the Docker command. So you can see here, Docker pull Ubuntu. When we use Singularity, it's a little bit different. It's still Singularity pull, except you need to put the host of the container in front of the name of the container that you want to download. So in this case, we do Singularity pull Docker colon 2/ Ubuntu. If you want to download a specific version, so for instance, in Ubuntu's case, there are different versions of the Ubuntu operating system, all the way from 18.04 to 21.04, which was just recently released. You put a colon in front of, you do name of the container, colon version, to get a specific version of the container downloaded. So this, you know, is very similar with PyPy. If you did pip install numpy equal, you know, 1.19.4 to get a very specific version of NumPy as opposed to the latest version of NumPy, if that's important for your workflow. All right, so that's kind of a basic intro to containers. So we're gonna go ahead and get straight into our exercise today. And our exercise today is very simple. We are going to try and download and enter into a container that has a different operating system than our host's operating system. Okay, so again, I'm here on Quest as a temporary user. And to figure out what my host operating system is on Quest, I can see here that this is a Red Hat Enterprise Linux version 7.5, okay? And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna download a container that has a completely different operating system inside of it than my host's operating system. So let's choose Ubuntu, since I happened to refer to that in a previous slide. So most HPC systems are going to have Singularity installed into them, okay? So in our case, Quest has Singularity installed as a module. And you can see if I run which Singularity and Singularity -- version, it tells me what version of Singularity I have installed. And right now we have 3.7.0, which is the latest or one of the latest versions of the Singularity program available on Quest. Point. All we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and download a container with an operating system different than Red Hat. So why don't we go ahead and choose Ubuntu, since I had it on the previous slides. In that example, we downloaded Groovy, but since Ubuntu just released a new version of the operating system, why don't we download a container which has that operating system installed in it? I believe it's called Hirsute. So all you have to do is you type Singularity pull. Where does the container live? In this case, Docker Hub. What is the name of the container? And what is the specific name or specific version of the container that we would like to download. So what it does is it essentially downloads a bunch of blobs or layers that contain all of the necessary sort of information about what's in this container, what essentially is needed for the container to be able to run the programs that are contained inside of it. So we've successfully downloaded Ubuntu Hirsute. If we list the contents, we can see what the name of the file that was created is. It's a Singularity image file, so .sif. And what we can do is first, we can see how big it is. So you can see that just a container that has Ubuntu in it is actually very small. It's very small, very portable. And so why don't we go ahead and give a little sneak peek of the next video in this series by entering inside of the container and demonstrating how you can see that we are now in a shell or an environment that contains an entirely different operating system than our hosts. And you can see here it says Hirsute Ubuntu 21.04. So next video, we will go ahead and we will be discussing these commands, Singularity, Exec, and Shell, as well as other basic usage of how to interact with the container now that we've downloaded it onto our system. So I hope everyone joins me for that next video. Otherwise, have a great rest of your day.